welcome back to another episode of GHE Diaries. Today we have with us Pranav Mehrotra. Hello Pranav, how are you doing?
Hey Vishal, I'm doing well, thanks.
It's great to have you here, Pranav. We are so excited to have you as well, since you were on the expedition. I happen to forget, what year was it?
So I think I was in 2014. That was the second year of GHE back then.
Early years of GHE. What was it, one standoff point for GHE that, that made you choose GHE over other such organizations?
Yeah, I think, so back then when I was looking at similar organizations for IEEE Smart Village, one thing that really stood out about GHE, and it wouldn't be a surprise, was the kind of communities it was working in. So if I remember the landscape back then, at least, a lot of these organizations were working in states like Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. But I think GHE was pretty much the only one looking at these unique set of communities which were in the Himalayan regions. And even to discover these villages and know the existence of these villages was pretty much, you had to trek 3 to 4 days to find them, discover them. So I think that was quite unique, that, working in such a remote region which pretty much nobody is looking at, and making an impact over there was something that was very unique to me. And I thought, this is an organization I would want to contribute, not just because I know Paris, but also because it is quite unique. And that's where I said, I should get IEEE to pursue this partnership with GHE.
So I'm just trying to put up a timeline for myself, Pranav, here. You were with NI, you were simultaneously working with IEEE. Now that you've figured out that, GHE is an organization that you want to probably work with, and now so you've made up your mind, the next step was probably coming up signing up for an expedition, right? So how did that process look like? I mean, was it a proper, were you just a participant on an expedition, or was it an, if I'm not wrong, it was an IEEE thing that you did, right? So can you explain a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. So I think there was multiple steps between finding GHE and saying yes, sign up, and just coming. So I think there was quite a big number of steps that were involved, because I think the way I was looking at GHE was not just for me to go on the expedition, participate and be done with it, but more from a longer term partnership between IEEE Smart Village and GHE, right? So it started early 2014, and then when I pitched IEEE Smart Village to Paris and Paris to IEEE Smart Village is when it started. And then it was really, I think, several months were spent by all of us in terms of figuring out what that partnership would look like, because any partnership, each party has certain interests in mind and there's certain value that could be brought in. So the discovery of both these things, value, interest, takes a certain amount of time, and my role was in terms of orchestrating it. I had a massive personal, I would say, motivation, because one, I thought the two organizations would really value from each other, and then number two was, it's, I think it was a great initiative for me to be part of as well. So I think I was personally very motivated to make it work. So I think as the run up towards the getting the partnership and getting IEEE Smart Village to say yes, and figuring out a pilot, was to find out where exactly IEEE could support. And there were two themes. Number one, the first theme was on the education side. And back then, GHE used to have this education e-base in Leh. So I think one of the things was to kind of pilot some of the projects which IEEE Smart Village has on the education base. Second theme was almost for IEEE to do a, I would say, almost like a diligence to see, is this an organization they could partner with in the longer horizon? And is there a community where their efforts on electrification could be plugged in? So I think those were the two themes of the partnership that we landed on. And my role was to, cover both of these. Number one, get those projects up and running on the education side of the e-base. And secondly, understand how GHE is operating their electrification, efforts with communities. How are they setting up the village entrepreneur model? How are they setting up the DC grid, which was again unique at back that point of time. So almost doing a diligence to understand. And then once I come back from the expedition, based on how it goes, it could be a longer partnership between IEEE and GHE. So I think those were the two short-term and long-term outcomes that the partnership had in mind. And that's why the run-up was quite getting them onboarded, both the sides, and then me as a kind of going on the expedition as a pilot for the pilot project was also it was all the effort that went to the run-up to the expedition, I would say. So a lot of convincing around.
And once you reached Ladakh, I mean, was it your first trip to Ladakh?
It was my first trip to Ladakh, yes.
And how was that experience like? I mean, the landscape is awestruck, but how was it like for you? I mean, what are your expectations when you landed in Leh?
So I think I remember, so I flew, I used to live in Hyderabad, so I took the flight Hyderabad-Delhi, and then I had an early morning Delhi-Leh flight, and it was something I've never seen, and I have, even after it, like, you know, I've traveled to several places around the world, but I still haven't seen some place as surreal and unique and beautiful as Ladakh, I would say. And just landing there, looking at the mountains, I've been to a lot of, like, you know, hill stations in India, but again, Leh was very unique. The kind of mountains, the color schemes you have over there, just the entire vibe of the place with the different army bases being around, I think it was very, very unique. I don't think there's any other place like that that I have seen yet.
I agree
have
with you,
you
I guess.
Have you been to Leh Ladakh or no, Vishal?
I have been, yes. So, I totally agree with you. There's no other place like Leh Ladakh. So, we are good on that. I guess, so once you were in Leh, Pranav, how was it like for you, know? How was the experience like? Who was there to greet you? Let's start with that. And then, what were your expectations out of the expedition, of other participants that were on the expedition?
Yeah, so I think the other attraction I had towards GHE was the kind of participant it gets, because it was a very unique, so not just, you know, enthusiastic trekkers as such, because I wasn't an enthusiastic trekker at all. I think that's Ladakh, that this GHE has been my only trek so far, like proper trek, where it is more than, like, you know, it's not just a date like you're doing. So it's basically, I think they bring together a very diverse set of people. When I say diverse, it's, of course, nationalities is one thing. Also, backgrounds that people have, the expectations they have. But the commonality is the impact they want to make, right? So I think that was very interesting, another attraction for me as well. And I think to answer your specific question, we had, of course, Paris receiving us at the airport. And there's us going to the specific guest house in Leh, I remember. And I think once you reach Leh, I think the unique part about it is also, it's at, I think, 11,000 feet or something, right? And when you fly from Hyderabad at sea level and you reach 11,000 feet, there is, of course, it takes a day to acclimatize. And that's not, and I didn't, like, you know, I'd heard of this, oh, you need to acclimatize, spend 1 or 2 days. I thought, yeah, it must be for, like, old people or stuff like that. But I think it's pure biology at play. The oxygen levels are actually low, and it takes a while for your body to get used to that oxygen level. And I think one really good thing that the GHE team, at least back then, did was you had a very nice ramp up before the actual trek. So day one, you do nothing, you pretty much chill out there. Day two, you start exploring Leh city itself, because there's so much to see, so much to do. And it's not that every day you go to Leh. So I think there's a lot of exploring happening in day two, in just Leh itself, going to the markets, walking around. Then you start going to, like, you know, venturing out slightly to, let's say, Pangong Lake and stuff like that. You cross passes, again, you're hitting more altitudes. Then you go cycling around Leh as well. So I think there's a lot of warm-up and prep that happens before you actually hit the trek part, which is quite good as well. So I think, yeah, that's the long answer to your short question.
What was one key takeaway that, you know, from the expedition back in 2014 that you've taken with yourself out of it, and something that, you know, you believe that has helped change the way you think of things in your daily life, something along those lines?
Yeah, so I think that's a great question, and I think I really am enjoying this call, because this is a good way for me to kind of relive those memories, relive those kind of emotions and think back. So I think I want to say thank you again for, you know, inviting me for this. If I think of three, so the three things that really I took away, right? And so number one for me was in terms of, you know, being fortunate for the things we have, right? So, like, till then you would get irritated if you have a power cut for an hour, right? But this was a place where there was no concept of power cut, because they didn't have power, right? So I think being fortunate almost on a periodic basis of the things you have, especially in these challenging times, to think of the COVID situation. I think a lot of people complain about being locked at home or not being able to go out. But if you just think of being in a safe home, having access to connectivity, being able to video call with your family, I think that's a that's a blessing, I would say. And I think being fortunate about things you have was number one learning I had, right? And I think that has pretty much helped me. And I won't say it's like, oh, you suddenly change from the next day of the expedition. I think it's a subtle changes that happen subconsciously, which you might not realize until you really force yourself and reflect, right? And it's almost like a slight, subtle personality change. So I think that's one. The second thing is the, like, you know, for me specifically was, like, you know, always finding ways to give back to community. I think there is more to life than just working, than just, like, you know, personal life as such. There is, I think, we are responsible to give back to community. And I really believe in that, right? In the aspect of good karma, I would say I really believe in that. I think that's the second thing that I took away. And I still, like, you know, find ways to give back. And it might not always be, like, you know, going to a trek and then electrifying. So it could be something like, you know, somebody looking for a job, somebody looking for advice, just, you know, taking out time and, you know, sharing that with them. I think there is a lot of value in that as well. So I think that's the second thing. Third thing, I think more personal, was, you know, I was really, like I said, it was quite complex to bring these two organizations, IEEE and GHE, together. And I was super persistent, right? Like, I didn't give up. So I think being persistent is something else I learned in terms of, specifically when, you know, going on something as challenging as this, is the other takeaway that I took from this.
Thank you for sharing that. These are three really beautiful points. And, you know, I guess persistence and constantly trying to push yourself to, you know, move out of your comfort zone, so that, you know, one small step that you take, we don't really ever realize, you know, how big a difference can it make on someone else's life until you actually do that. So that's something that, thank you for sharing that, Pranav. And now that you share, you know, that the third point was about the partnerships, and you've seen that IEEE and GHE have come a long way since then. What do you think of, you know, GHE from back 2014 or to into 2020? How do you think GHE has evolved, and, you know, what do you think GHE probably can do more in terms of community intervention? And now that you must have been, you know, you're familiar with all the different initiatives that GHE has already taken up, what do you think of GHE now?
Yeah, so I always used to, like, number one, I'm quite proud of how IEEE and GHE evolved. I know, like, I think there was a full expedition a few years down the line that IEEE did the GHE. It was the National Geographic. So that's something I'm really, really proud of. Like, you know, converting the skepticism of the IEEE team in the start to a full-fledged partnership, getting so many villages electrified as part of that partnership is something I'm really, really, you know, proud of, that, you know, 3 months of persistence was able to create so much impact for the two organizations. So that's one. I think GHE has for sure come a long way. I used to think that, you know, Parash would do this for 2-3 years and then go back to a corporate job as such. Right? That's honestly what I used to think. But I think I'm quite impressed, and the way he has taken this organization to a fully fledged, running global organization, I would say, with a global network of alumni making some contributions here and there always because of the catalyst GHE is. So I think there are two layers of impact GHE makes. One is, of course, the direct impact it makes around those villages and to the lives of people of those villages. But I think there's also a second degree impact it makes to the participants of GHE, like, you know, even yourself, right? Over a weekend, you're doing this interviewing. So I'm sure there is a secondary effect it brings into the participants and the team and being involved with something, and they continue to give something back. So I think that's a pretty interesting thing GHE has come towards. And I know they've diversified itself as well in terms of homestays and in terms of, I know, like, some astronomy stuff, which is quite cool and interesting as well, because I think they're helping the communities in Ladakh become more sustainable, become more economically stronger, and live better lives. So I think it's quite impressive, and the grids are still working, at least the last that I heard.
Yes, they are. Again, thank you, you know, for sharing this part. And I guess with that, we are good to go. Once again, Pranav, thank you for your time today. And it's been wonderful talking to you. It's been wonderful hearing your experience, you know, your side of the story. Any last words that you have for any future participant for an expedition?
No, not really. I think it's a great thing. I think people should do it. It's pretty much once in a lifetime for a lot of people, and they should not hesitate to do it, because it's a very rare opportunity, and they should seize it when they can.
It's so it's just capturing the moment. Got it. Thank you, Pranav. We'll launch this episode soon, so for you as well. And with that, for our audience, I'll just say that, you know, we'll come up with another episode real soon. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Vishal.